Hi, folks. I'm very excited to be here. I'm from Chennai. Who are from Chennai? Yeah. Raise your hands. Hey. Okay. Not many. Okay. So this is my first Vue conference, like attending a talk at a Vue conference. So today we are going to see about like using building form components using Vue.js in a large scale application. So I am Bharath. I'm a front end engineer at Chargebee. So a little bit about Chargebee. Chargebee is a subscription management platform that helps you untangle recurring revenue business from spaghetti building. So basically we take care of the subscription part of your application. So we are about like 9,000 customers in 50 countries, and we have support more than 20 payment gateways. So today's topic, like I'll be speaking about two things. Why a company like Chargebee, a SaaS company like Chargebee, chose Vue as its Vue layer. And we'll be talking about the forms, what are the problems we faced and how we solved it. So we chose, like, there are multiple factors when we consider. We, like, 2 years back, we had an option whether to choose React or Angular or Vue. So those were the popular at the time. So Vue was just bubbling up. There are like many factors we considered. One such factor is a fast learning curve. At the time, we are like about 60 developers. Most of them were expert in Java. And our tech stack was like Java Enterprise Edition with JSP for the front end. So we don't have any like expert in JavaScript, expert in HTML, CSS. So we have like traditional HTML developers and CSS developers. So we chose Vue because of that. It seems easily approachable. And it was easy to onboard a new hire. So let's say a fresher joins a team and he was able to deliver within a day. So it doesn't take any steep learning curve. It's very easy to learn. And one more thing was like documentation part. So when you compare it with Angular or React, so I would suggest like Vue.js documentation is pretty clear and simple. So you can easily understand. So whoever's new to the single page application can easily understand. So like a starting point to learn a single page application, how it works. Versatile. Since I said our app is like a monolithic 7-year-old legacy application with a lot of edge cases and complex logic, building logic. And we want to choose a framework, and we don't want to sit and like 3 to 7 months and revamping the entire product. We want to choose a framework or library that integrates with our existing app, and we are able to deliver like within a month. So previously, right, if you are developing a complex UI animation with jQuery or JavaScript or any third party thing, it will take time. So Chargebee is like a user experience focused company, and we have like user experience, and we have like complex animation logic. Okay. So with Vue.js, we were able to develop it within a single day. Like previously we were taking about 3 to 4 days to develop a animation. So it became very easy to develop because of the animation hooks the Vue provides. So end of the day, as a business matter, it is how fast you deliver it. Design principles. So we choose because like the decoupled HTML, CSS, JS that comes out of the box of Vue. Since Vue is very flexible, so instead of writing in React and having a JSX, so we had HTML CSS developer who doesn't want to write CSS in JS. So that's why we choose Vue. This was a major selling point to our investors and CTO. Single file components, yeah, the template part, it was very easy like to debug and manage and maintain the application. And the final part was the dependency tracking system, the reactivity. So at that time, since like Vue is not backed by any big product companies, and there wasn't any patterns at that time, and it was just bubbling up. So Chargebee loves philosophy. So what happens after 2 years, even Vue drops a project and goes to another project. So since we went to the source code and we were able to understand easily how does Vue works. So even if that stopped, we were able to pick it up and then continue it. That's a major point for every enterprise company. So as community driven, like as Swapnil said, like we have RFCs. So when compared to other frameworks, we use something like that is community driven. There is RFC. Once RFC is approved by every, like most of developers, once it get upward, and only then it will be moved to the version. That's the thing. Well, coming to the performance, so you don't have to do anything like improve the performance of the view. It comes out of the box when compared to React, where you have to write in a such a way code, like you optimize the code. So React doesn't do for it for you. So Vue does out of the box, doesn't need to do it. So less in size when compared to other frameworks. So in Chargebee, we have two applications. One is a web console as well as the checkout pages. So that the checkout page runs on third party or customer's end. So we want something that is lightweight. So we chose Vue. Finally, suits are made. Like we are using Vue for last 2 years and we didn't find any problem. Even if the problem comes, we were able to solve it using Vue. We were able to harness the power of Vue. So that's how Vue is flexible. So coming to today's topic, forms. Well, building forms that has like more than 10 form fields, and each form field has a relationship between other form fields, and it's not just normal text. Let's assume like we have currency input, date picker, time with time zone support. It's pretty hard to manage and maintain it, and even write unit test cases. This is Anthony Good. Many of you know about him. Like we have UGS developer. He's the owner, CEO of UGSdeveloper.com website, and he's writing a book on building enterprise application using Vue.js. So this is a tweet from him. So he says like building a very big forms using component-based library, let's say even it's Vue, React, or Angular, it's very difficult to, it's not maintainable. That's what he says. So this is like a normal form, average form in Chargebee. So it's not a norm generic form where you have a form builder and then it's not normal templates. Look at like, we have like animations as a relationship and there's a logic going behind. We'll be having a API call to the backend to fetch some data. This is how it looks. And this is not a generic template pattern. Each form behaves in a different way, is pleasing to the user experience. So let's dive into building form. So this is from a Vue.js documentation website. If you're building a form, so like as a input field, the username, and we have the options part that has a binding to the username. So the template field has username field and the submit button. And the form has the callback submit form, and you're making sub. This is our normal basic form in a Vue.js application. So let's assume you're building a form with client-side validation. So let me go through the code pen and how it looks like. So here we have the input field, and we have the email field, and we have the option select option fields. So this is, so here we have the validation. So we have the bindings here, and we have the errors part that displays the, that will enter the errors if it has. So on clicking submit, we will have the post check form. The check form function checks whether name is required, name is there, email is there, and checks the email length. And for valid email, we have a regex. So this is how it looks like. So when I enter submit or selecting anything, this is how it looks like. So this is like building a basic naive approach of having a form with basic validations without using any third-party libraries or any modeling. So let's build. Let's look at server-side validation. So this form, so basically we have the same as before. The only thing new is we are making an API call. On the response of the API call, we are pushing the errors to render it in the error array. So product is required. So let's look at the community plugins available. So ViewForm, it's a form validation library. So these are the popular libraries you can find on Awesome Vue. So we validate, it's a template based validation library. I'll show you an example of it. And view form generator is something like a form generator that generates a components for using a JSON. Okay, so these are three variants you can find. So let's see how to build a, what if we build a form using view form library? So here we have the mapping binding fields, name, password, and confirm password. And if you look at the template, this is a sample template of our form field will look like when you use a form view form. So basically the entire form is being covered by view form in the template, and we have a validate that covers the that wraps the input field, and we have field messages that renders the if there's any messages for the particular field. And here's a normal form, the input tag. That's it. Simple as that previously. So the response will contain something like this. For each field, we'll have a name, what's the data, pristine, valid, invalid, so all this kind of stuff. So the render part is something, it's very simple. We have these three fields, name, password, and confirm password. That's it. Okay. So if you submit it without it, that's how it works. So each error should be mapped to the particular field. Simple as that. So you guys went through like all the examples. So what we found? So validations are duplicated in clients and backend side. So basically any form, any post action will have a validation at the server side. It's the best practice to do a validation at both client and server side. So here the validation part is duplicated in the client side as well as in the server side. What if like it's very difficult to maintain on a application that has 100 plus forms, where each form field is very important in a mission critical application? The second part is handling server error messages. You can see like the component that holds the form handles the way it displays the error messages. So that will be duplicated in all the places. Let's say each component level like slight variations of it, but end of the day, like you will be duplicating the same code everywhere. Spaghetti code. Let's assume if a form contains like 12 plus form fields, and let's assume based on a value of the entered in the first field, the like fifth field or sixth field get rendered, or the options get changed. In that case, the validation and submission part are shared between the parent and child. Anyway, we won't be keeping the entire form in a single component. We'll break down into small components. So we will have some ugly refs, and then we will be calling the child. It's like an anti-pattern. It won't be easy to test it. That's what the fourth point says. So how do you write a? So it's very difficult to write a test unit test. So how do you test basically like the business logic of the form field? So it's quite difficult, and it's not scalable. So any product will have it will grow, will have new features. So the number of form fields and the components keeps on growing; it never stops. So let's tame the form beast then. So what our goal should be like? It should be simple. It should be maintainable. It should be easier to test. It should be dry, and it's flexible to adopt any kind of form fields in the requirement of the future. Demo. So we're going to be building a simple form field, a form like having a phone number that has a master input and a password field. This is our simple example of a form. So let's look at the structure of the form component structure look like. So we'll be having a form, and we'll have a form field form that's a renderless component that wraps the form field. This is the actual form field which renders the UI. So each component takes care of a different business logic. It has a different roles. Let me walk through each one of them. Field. It takes care of the rendering part. And so So it's a single, it's a source of truth, right? User interacts with the form. So it will emit events, all this to the parent thing. It can work independently with our form wrapper. It doesn't want to have a form wrapper for each and everything. You just want a search field or a normal unit input field. You can have it. And it can have a custom masking logic too. Field form, here it's a wrapper container component, nothing fancy. So on creation, it registers the form. So basically, we will be moving the entire form state to the store. We'll be maintaining this form state to store so that any part of the application can interact with the store and get the values from the form. So on creation, like on the lifecycle hook of the form for field form component, so it registers the particular field to the store and it will attach the listeners to the field and it on validates the it takes care of the validation and updates the store. So this component is the one that interacts with the store, not the field component. So on destroy, it removes the field from the store. So this is how it interacts with. So basically, the role of the field form component is to interact with the store and update nothing, doesn't do any, doesn't transform the log value or anything sort of that. The actual form component, so basically on creation, it registers it itself to the store and it takes care of loading the validation part from the client side or the, from the backend. So basically in Chargebee, we load validation either from OpenAPI spec. So we are API first company, we'll be loading the, we'll be writing spec. So we'll be generating validation from this OpenAPI spec itself. We use Swagger for it. And since it's a legacy app, so basically we will dynamically generate form field validations from the backend app itself. So we have a framework that supports it, that gives the form, list of form fields and the validation related to it. So either way, we can load it. It takes care of the form submission part. So on destroy, it removes the object from the store, form object from the store. Let's see the working demo. Let me show you the example, and then let's walk through what is happening. So basically. Cannot be blank. So this is how it works. Okay. So let me walk through the code working logic. So on mount, what's happening is we have a form store and we have a form. So form creates the sign up form. Let's assume that's a sign up form. That sign up form gets loaded to the form store along with the validators. So this is a text field form. What we see in the phone number field, like the normal text field, and the password is also a text field with a custom type. So your phone number gets filled, gets registered inside the signup form. And we have the text field that gets rendered into the UI. That's it. Let's see what happens on user input. Let's assume the user interacts with the text field. The value gets sanitized and then emits to the parent. The parent is the wrapper form field. So it renders the, it rend, so basically, in certain case scenarios, we'll be loading the form field. Values to the form itself, right? So it takes care of that part too. So text field form updates the form store on every event from the text field. So it takes the validation and updates this form state. So let's say like in a form field, you have like error state, right? So this takes care of the validation part. So on destroy, text field form deletes the form phone number text field from the sign up form. So basically, I showed a demo previously, right? So where we have a in a sample form in Chargebee, we have a template that goes beyond back and forth. So in that case, let's assume a field that gets unmounted will automatically get removed from the form store. So we don't have to write the logic, hey, remove this form field from the store, or remove this form field from the form state that contains a, that the component that contains this form state. It works automatically. Form deletes the form on destroy form deletes the form store, nothing fancy new. That's it. The reason why we chose this approach is in checkout where our end developers like the was integrating checkout through the site can modify the styles of the form, the custom masking logic, validation, everything. And the problem we had was, why can't we go with the form generator? The problem is, if you go with a form generator, then we will be following a generic pattern of the form field. like not generic traditional form. But if you look at our app, we have a custom template. We don't know like what will be the template of the HTML part. It can, we will have a section down there. We will have a link there and a text and a heading in between. So it was very difficult to dynamically render the HTML template part. So what we did, we hard coded the template in the HTML, and the whether to show the field or not comes dynamically from the business logic. So that's the basic in a nutshell we had done it. So this is like, as I said, in validation. So right, left hand side, you can find the OpenAP spec. This is a one of our form field that handles currencies. So here we have refund amount as an integer, money format is money value. So we can easily validate whether it's a valid money for in a format or what kind of, can be anything. So basically we use OpenAP spec for this kind of things. It's a standard pattern. On the right side, is the way we load the form validators and then we dynamically load into the store. What are the key takeaways? Separation of concerns. So you can see each layer takes care of a particular part. So it's very easy to test, and we can say like this, hey, this component does this one. Even for a fresher, let's assume we have like 100 plus form components and in every page it works differently. It is very difficult for a fresher to go and modify it. With this approach, like we are able to, you can easily say, hey, this component does this one. Nothing fancy or nothing other than that. So basically we didn't go for a custom logic or some other thing from the outside, like patterns or libraries. We use whatever available in the view. So any problem arises, so we as a solution for it, guys. Vue is very flexible. It has a solution inside it. You are just to find out. Follow like API first development for any form fields. Otherwise, it's kind of messy. Like it will be like a spaghetti code in the end. And make it developer friendly. Like even for a fresher, if you look at the code, they should feel like, hey, it's very easy to modify it and test it. So that was the core point of this talk. Thanks. Like any questions like you have like regarding Chargebee or Vue or forms?
We can take about 5 questions.
So I had one confusion. So the first time when the form loads, how do you manage the state? So suppose we have 20 forms in a page.
20 form fields or 20
forms? 20 forms.
20 forms.
Yeah. So we have login, sign up, this and that, and 20. So how do you manage the state in that?
So each form field will have a separate object. It has a separate object. Let's assume there's a state object, and let's assume sign form is a child of that object. Say, in a nutshell, like it's just an object.
So you will dynamically create the state.
You will dynamically register it and deregister it. So that like any page can interact with it. Let's assume like any component somewhere in the page can interact with it, and let's assume like what value does.
So we have a big form store that has separate state getters and everything.
Yes.
And in that particular state, you have all the 20 forms. And
yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi. So your approach has a hard dependency on the store. Store being the Vuex store.
Basically, you can use Vuex store or you can use the observables as well.
Okay. So do you think what is the right approach to, let's say if we try to make this approach as a generic one, let's say we publish this library on GitHub or something, and at this point, the library or the architecture would be have a hard dependency on the store object, store being the Vuex store, right? So how do you try to make it generic? Because the store could be at an enterprise level application, could be fragmented into different modules. Okay, in that case, you would be trouble in the named module space, or could be at the just root level module space. So how would you try to identify and register the or try to solve that problem?
So end of the Vuex is also like a normal view component that has a reactivity, and we have some flex pattern doing it. So you can use Vue.js, let the macro version of Vue as a Vue observable thing, and you can use it as a state object and then interact with it. So end of it's React. So end of it's React.
Okay, so in that case, so your approach will still have a third-party dependency, Vue observable, right?
No, Vue has exposed its own, it's a stone API. If okay. you look at the documentation, you can find it.
Okay.
It's there in the
Hi. Hi. So at my workplace, we also deal with lots of huge forms, and this has been a recurring issue. So the approach that we took towards sort of at least managing the form definitions was to go with a very descriptive JSON representation of the entire form, including each of the element as well as the relationship that would go and the rules that would bind all of them together. And then we use this JSON representation both on the client side and the server side to make sure that we are able to both validate the forms with same validation rules, both on the client side and the server side, along with making sure that we are able to upgrade components as well as forms systematically across our applications, making sure that everywhere, we are able to push that update everywhere. So I just wanted to get your opinion on how, I mean, you find this approach compared to how you have been going about handling larger forms.
Okay, to summarize what you said, so basically you are using a JSON form, like a form builder.
JSON representation, a much descriptive one, which has everything right from the how to style that particular element to the validation rules that would apply, or some binding rules to other elements within that form, like Got show it. Hide rules and stuff like
so
that.
So basically like form generator, if you give the form JSON to a builder, it builds a form for you and then does the validation.
Yeah, you can more or less kind of through a builder, or we have a custom script that generates those JSONs depending yes. upon the requirement.
Okay. Actually, it depends upon the scenarios. Let's assume in your case, let's take a checkbox and a text. So it will be same across your app. But in our use case was like our design team, based upon the scenarios and the use case, we had a different styling and a different way the HTML is structured. So we can't build, then the JSON will become very complex and it won't be developer friendly, and it will be like, oh, what JSON is going to do? So your approach is depends upon the scenario. Your approach is generic and right. To your use case, if you have a generic form fields, like this is the input field, this is the checkbox, and this is select box, this is how it works, and this is a relationship. It's fixed and hardcore. Like in that case, it's correct. But in our case, it was a pretty complex and difficult.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
We can take one last question.
Hi, could you like highlight some of the key differences between Bootstrap view forms and this view form package apart from the dependency on the store?
Okay, so this doesn't have a difference. So basically in Chargebee, we have our own library. We didn't use like Bootstrap or any other Beautify, any other framework or CSS as well.
Yeah.
So this doesn't depend on the template. It's up to you. So the developer defines the template. So this is what nothing but the thinking of the logic between the store and the component. So previously this logic will be present inside the component itself. So we moved it, make it dry, and then moved it to store.
Okay.
So we found a generic pattern. So this is how it works in most
Thank
of
you.
The cases.